In a socially distanced world, Design United is an optimistic digital platform for collaborative design and connection. Design United was created in March 2020 during a period of intense lockdown and quarantine measures within the region. The aim behind Design United was to create an optimistic space for regional dialogue, connections, collaborations, and opportunities for young regional designers and design practices. A much-needed network of support and peer mentorship during these uncertain times. Talented young designers and design studios working on design innovation with an approach that is relevant to our South Asian region have been invited to be a part of the platform. We also encourage design students from the region to share their work, be involved in the dialogue, and to be an active part of Design United. Design United, most of all, believes in creating a community of designers and design knowledge that is largely contextual, with focus on contributing to the environment and our community. Design United believes greatly in a spirit of collaboration and idea exchange.
Welcome to Design United's 40th Design Conversation, a conversation with two talented design firms from India, C-Lab, led by Anand Sonicha, based in Ahmedabad, and Field Atelier, led by Teja and Yatin Fuleri, based in Goa. I'm Varuna Shashidhar, founder principal of a regional landscape practice, VSLA, based in Bengaluru. I'm supported by my wonderful DU and VSLA team in this endeavor, along with Clayworks Spaces. Clayworks creates flexible co-work spaces that focuses on productivity and sustainability. They also offer complete work from home solutions. Design Conversations and Design United has featured talented emerging designers from our region, India, Nepal, Sri Lanka, Pakistan, Bangladesh, selected for their innovative approaches and practices that have a deep resonance with the place they are from. Design United firmly believes in interdisciplinary conversations, learning, and believing that this will lead to a cross-pollination of ideas across various designs and a richer collaborations. We've also had brilliant mentors, regional designers with great expertise and commitment to mentoring younger generation of designers. Our most recent mentorship module featured two inspirational regional designers, architect Sanjay Mohe from Mindspace India and architect Tanuj Goenka, director at Kerry Hill Architects Singapore. So please continue to join us on Saturdays for the conversation. With this background to Design United, let's move to the much anticipated presentation and conversation. It's indeed a delight to introduce and welcome Anand Sonicha from C-Lab and architects Teja and Yatin from Field Atelier. Anand Sonicha studied architecture at IPSA Rajkot. He's also worked with Pritzker Award-winning architect Professor B.V. Doshi in Ahmedabad, as well as the renowned architect Alvaro Cesar. C-Lab is based in Ahmedabad and is led by Anand. C-Lab was born out of his interest to design with time and quality and reflect on the social and cultural implications of architecture. C-Lab's recent projects include Jai Jagat Theatre at the historic Sabarmati Ashram in Ahmedabad, Housing for the Loving Community in Ahmedabad, and the School for the Blind and Visually Impaired Children in Gandhinagar. Anand's work have been exhibited at Gallery Romain Roland Alliance Francaise, New Delhi, Faculty of Arts, Design and Humanities, De Montfort University, UK, Also recently, Jai Jagat Theatre at Sabarmati Ashram was published in Casabella, Italy, with an essay, The Effect of Proportionate Measures by architect Alvaro Siza. We're indeed extremely delighted to welcome Anand and C-Lab to Design Conversation. Our second design studio presenting at Design Conversation today is Field Atelier, led by Teja Amonkar and Yatin Fuleri, who both graduated from Goa College of Architecture and worked under master architects B.V. Doshi and architect Bijoy Jain. Field Atelier is an architectural practice and studio established in Goa in 2015. The studio works with a small team of people. It also works with builders and carpenters who handle work on site. The process of design for the studio begins with questioning the nature of the site and the belief. The initial atavistic feeling that the site and its forces evoke. This feeling deserves a certain gesture in terms of space and order to simply coexist on site. So it's indeed extremely wonderful that Teja and Yatin are joining us today. We'd like to begin the presentation with C-Lab. I would like to request Anand Sanicha to please share his work. Thank you.
Thank you so much for the invitation, and it is a pleasure to share the works today. Today I'm going to focus on one project, School for the Blind and Visually Impaired Children, since we have limited time, because I would like to show the process of the project. Before showing the School for the Blind and Visually Impaired Children's project, I would like to also share a little bit about our studio and what other works that we have been doing, but very briefly. So we are a small practice based in Ahmedabad, and the works which we have are in and around Ahmedabad. This is our studio. Here are the two architects, Anish Devi and Akash Dave. They work with me since some years. It's a very cozy place and very chaotic. We like to be surrounded with the works that we really admire and learn from them constantly. This is during the pandemic. We recently started working, going to the office and working from the studio. Some of the works that we have completed, this is Jai Jagat Theatre in Sabarmati Ashram. It was built as a part of 100 years of celebration of 100 years of ashram. It was built in 2017. These are some of the photographs of how it's been used. Another project we completed in Sabarmati Ashram is the volunteer houses. There are many volunteers who come to work in and around Sabarmati Ashram to volunteer. This was a housing for them. Housing for the Loving Community is another ongoing project where we are working on the houses for a community who is affected with leprosy disease, and their houses flood every monsoon. So till now we built 10 houses since the last 2 years, and four more we are going to build this year. This is another project, canteen for Indubai Park School of Architecture. When I was a student, I just graduated, and this was my first project. It was in collaboration with one of my friends. I made a lot of mistakes in this project, and it was a very good experience. And this is where our practice also started. Currently, we are working on exhibition. We were invited to participate in Seoul Biennale. So we are working on this project at this moment, where we are investigating wall as an architectural element with the capacity to divide and connect, protect or exclude. So we are looking at different condition in Ahmedabad city, how wall as an element is creating transformation to life and spaces. So just to give a sense that this is a wall of IIM Ahmedabad, and on one side of the wall, there are people living, and on the other side is like a very pleasant environment where students study. So it's a duality of a wall in the city. And then there is, if you walk forward, there is another condition where there is a very small puncture where a person who is selling mascarpone and tea, and students enjoy his services for the last 30 years. So these are like some of the works that we have been doing, just an overview of our practice. Now I'll focus on the School for the Blind and Visually Impaired Children. So this project, we were commissioned in 2014, and now luckily that it is being constructed. So it was a very long process that we have been going through. Approximately 39 million people are blind in the world, and India accounts to 20% of the total world's blind population, which is approximately 8 million. It is the same size of the population of New York or Ahmedabad, or five times of Munich. So around 90% of blind population is from the developing countries. Just to give a little bit of background about the school. So this school that we have been working on was started by two friends, Rehman and Hargobind, and with four children from a very small village, Kolovra. In villages and small town, there is no formal education facility for blind children, and the residential school was dedicated to education and well-being for the blind children from very remote villages and town. So this was the existing situation where there is this old primary school, which was government. It was transformed into the school and the residential facility for the blind children. So on the ground floor, they live, and on the top floor they study. And it was not a very good condition because it was not very specifically designed for the users, and it was an adaptive reuse building, and it was quite congested because, as you can see, that there are these beds which are like just stacked next to each other. They are bunk beds, so in one room there are 15 to 18 students living, and on top floor there is a very small, there are very small classrooms with very normal kind of benches where everyone sit back to back, which is not very ideal for the students. So this was the condition of the hostel when in 2014. So it was not a ideal situation. It was very risky because the bunk beds were too close to the ceiling fan, and it was not very easy for them to use the space. So the project started where we decided that we'll convert the existing building into the hostel block. We'll redistribute the rooms and we'll redistribute the beds. So the school, which was on the first floor, we build a new academic building, and we convert the entire existing building as a hostel block. And this gave a lot of possibilities where we could make like large dome rooms or very small intimate rooms where young adults can live. So there are a lot of possibilities which opened up at the moment we shifted the school. So as I told earlier, that we got this project in 2014, and I went around to many places in India to see the different schools, but I could hardly find schools that were specifically designed. Only recently I have started to understand that Professor Doshi had designed or Hasmukh Patel had designed, but I couldn't find before. Anyways, the point was that I could not find much examples. Only one school I was very impressed was in Mumbai, Victoria Memorial School, but again it was a colonial building, but it was very well maintained. It was very it was adapted to the needs of the blind children, so could learn something from that. And it was an uncharted territory, so I was working with the information that I had. So I was quickly looking at if this is the existing building, should I build next to it? If I should build on this big piece of land. I mean, and over time also the program changed, because in 2015, the requirements and the vision of the project was one. And then over time, the brief also was refined, the needs were changed. So it was quite an interesting process. Another alternative I was looking at was that because the need were bigger, so I thought that if I build something on the rear part of the existing building, then I could create a contained garden, and in the garden there are this this place where they could meet, they could learn. It could be a very interesting space, but it should be a contained space, because this land is 66 meters by 80 meters, quite a big land. So I was looking at this aspect. So it was a very simple idea, and another big constraint was the budget, of course, because they did not have money to build everything at one go. So the design had to be like incremental. So what we decided was that we create a contained garden, a movement space, and then the classrooms can be attached as and when it is required. So initially we decided we will build 3 or 4 classrooms, and those classrooms could be attached to this ring, and then whenever they have money they could keep adding and keep finishing the building. So this was something that was a very immediate idea. And then also I thought that why all the classroom has to be the same? It could have many different experiences in terms of volume and shape. So I will describe more the reasons of the geometry in the subsequent slides, but this was the idea that each classroom could be a unique experience for them. This was something that I worked for almost 8-10 months, this proposal. And after 1 year of working, we made these models and very detailed drawings to communicate, which I'll also show you more in detail in the later part of this presentation. In 2017, I had an opportunity to go to United States and work at Perkins School for the Blind. Because I was not very satisfied with the work that I was doing. And of course, when I was showing this proposal to the teachers there, I understood many things. So Perkins School for the Blind is the oldest school in the United States. It was first school actually in the United States for the blind children, where stalwarts like Helen Keller and Laura Bridgman and Anne Sullivan, they all studied there. Charles Dickens in his American Notes very fondly wrote about this experience. I think it was the only experience that he positively wrote about America. So it was a very interesting place. And when I saw the kind of facilities and the kind of possibilities, I was quite amazed that every student was very confident. They were not treated as differently than any other student. They had state of the art facilities for the education and living and everything. And I think that over time this campus has evolved, and the kind of research that they were doing were very inspiring. So I had the chance to work there for 5 months, where I volunteered there. I was working in the toddlers program, so this was the group that I was working with. So my job was to assist the teacher, Suzanne and Leah. And assist them and helping them around. But then I was also constantly observing how children move, how they use space, or how do they navigate, or how do they identify space. So just by being there for 5 months, I really gained a lot. And then, of course, the design process I used to share and discuss with them, and they also were very generous. They introduced me to one of the best researchers in the field of accessibility and navigation and other things. So I had a very insightful time in US. When I showed them this circular design, and the immediate reaction of those teachers were like that the students might get lost because circle has no edges. So the moment when you don't have any edges, you might get lost. And then I was immediately remembering Connaught Place, because whenever I used to go to Delhi, I always used to get lost in Connaught Place. So I always to have two references for me. One is the Indian flag and the Charles Correia's building. And that's what that those were my references to locate myself. And then I understood, yeah, it is true that if you have a circular movement, there is no way they could identify where they are, because we depend a lot on the visual sense to navigate, and that's where also other senses and surfaces and textures needs to be taken into account. So they also recommended that a geometry which is square also is not a very good idea, because all the sides are same, and they say that something which is rectilinear, where two sides are small, two sides are long, makes more sense. I mean, of course, it's difficult, but it makes more sense. So I also learned about navigation techniques through touch, to hearing, to smell, also with the light and contrasting color with partially vision students. So there were so many new things that I learned from Perkins, and I just by being there, and I saw their campus itself, I could understand that although it was very old campus, but it had some quality, and they've also adapted to the new needs. It was quite a learning experience. So I worked with the same idea, where I thought that there has to be a contained garden, because it's a big piece of land. So if there's a contained garden, then it's a very nice open to sky space. And then the movement is all around. So this ring is important, because if they want to build in phases, it's possible. So this ring, but now with all these learnings, I started to look the volumes in a very different way. So for example, this movement corridor. So one corridor was like wide and tall. So it is 3.6 meters by 3.6 meter in height. The opposite side is like very narrow and compact, so it is 1.8 meters by 2.2 meters. So, and then the roof slopes from one place to another. So at Perkins, I also saw that they did this variation in terms of volumes a lot, because when you are on a taller volume, when you talk, there is a very different kind of echo. And when you are in a very cozy place, when you talk, is a very different. Even your movement, when you your feet sound would be very different. At Perkins, I also saw that where they were like junctions, they dramatically increase the volume at the junction, so the students know that they are on the junction. So those learnings, I think that helped to in this design process. So a very tall volume and a very cozy volume, and then the roof slopes from one place to another. And this idea that the classrooms could be like an attachment, they could be added over the period of time, so they are like free in terms of the volume. And then this special classrooms that I was telling, because at Perkins I also saw that they had very interesting, I saw that they have the place where they could do movie screening, for example. So there is like a hall in which all the students gather, and then there is a descriptive movie for the blind and partially blind students. So I was very amazed with that, because it is like any other movie. There is a projection, there is a screen, but what changes is the description part. So because when we go to movie theaters, and there are so many things which are visual, that not everything is described. But in this descriptive movies, each moment which are visual is described. So for example, if a person is going walking and picking up the phone, in normal movie it will not be described because we know that that event is happening. But in this movie, descriptive movie, the movie pauses and then there is a description that, okay, the person wearing, I don't know, blue jeans, white shirt, is walking towards the telephone, which is yellow. There is a small window on the top where the light is coming, and he's going to pick the phone. And then the movie starts again. So it was quite interesting that how it made a lot of difference. So I also felt that children should enjoy this as a part of their school. So we also thought of this movie screening space, a classroom, which is a special classroom where we could project movies, like descriptive movies, or like workshop space. So special classroom has like special functions like movie screening and workshops and gatherings and meetings, where normal classrooms are like day-to-day classrooms where they study. And of course, these are like multifunctional spaces. So on the other day where there is no movie screening, this can be used as a classroom. And another important feature was that the special classroom has very different volume, and the light always is brought from the roof. In the normal classroom, the light is always brought from the courtyard. The reason is that partially blind students are very sensitive to direct light. So we had to always bring the reflected light. So if you will look at the plan, there are very less openings on the outside, almost no openings, but the classroom always opens to the courtyard. So it is the size of the classroom and the courtyard is the same. So it is like one big space, which one is closed and one is open. And then we bring the light always from the courtyards. In the special classroom, we always bring the light from the rooftop. So I'll show more details as we go along, but this classrooms have their own character. And then there's one big music hall because they are very good in music. And there was a specific need that we need to have like music hall where they could invite people and they could do performances. So this was important. So in section, you can see that these are the normal classrooms, which always open to the courtyard, and there's indirect light always. And then these are the special classroom where the light is always brought from the roof. And as you can see, this very tall volume gently goes down to a very small volume, and then sometimes the volume changes in the classroom. And normal classroom has very high volume, but the special classroom is like very small volume. This is the music hall, which opens to the courtyard. And when there is like large performance annual gathering, they could use the central courtyard. These are some of the drawings. These are some of the drawings. These are made by Akash. These are studies for the different light conditions. So this is the condition in the special classroom. This is the corridor. So as you can see, this very tall volume just slopes like this. And then the special classroom has a very different kind of an entry. So it has very tall entry, the light coming from top. So there is a contrast created in terms of light. And then the other classrooms are like small entrances. So these are like, this is the main entrance, and this the special classroom has like very tall entry with very stark light, contrasting light. So the surfaces are like different. This is the other side of the corridor. So one side, all the corners are also different. So this corner is curved. So it also helps to understand the sides. There are many ways of navigating. So one is also, one is the touch. I'll talk more about it soon. But all the corners are articulated in a very different way of the courtyard. So another navigation technique is the floor texture. So we decided very simply that the interior part has to be stone, the exterior part has to be brick. So there are two different materials which which clearly defines the space. So all the exterior courtyards has bricks and the interior part has stone. We are still thinking about brick or other stones. It's in the process, but this was our initial idea. And in stone also we have two textures. One is smooth texture and one is rough texture. So we are using Kota stone, and then wherever there is an entrance to the classroom, we have changed the texture. So there are always rough texture on the entrance to the classroom, so students understand that the classroom is here. Another navigation technique is through wall texture. So we have created different wall textures. So exterior part of the building has a very specific kind of a texture, which is grainy. The interior part has two kind of textures. So where there are classrooms, there is like a smooth texture. When there are the walls of the courtyard, there is rough texture. But then how do you know which side you're moving? So on the longer side, we have horizontal texture, and on the shorter side is always the vertical texture. So these are like different samples of texture that we make. And we also tested with students if they understand, because it was all speculation and we were trying to understand if this works or not. And only with time we'll understand how this works. But we did a lot of studies with the students to understand the floor texture, the wall textures, and other things. These are some of the photographs of the construction. So this is the special classroom where the movie screening will happen. This is another classroom where, special classroom where the light is all also brought from the top. It's a corridor. This is the normal classroom where you have the courtyard, which opens to the courtyard, and hopefully soon this will be very different. And now it is in a finishing stage. It's not complete yet. I mean, the doors and opening windows and many things have to be completed. The paint is not done, but you can see this difference in texture. So this is smooth Kota stone, this is rough Kota stone. And this light, of course, it changes the quality throughout the day. So this was during my visit in the morning. This is the roof which was sloping down. But I wanted to quickly discuss about the methods of communication, because this project also was unusual in terms of communication, because most of our work, architectural drawings and models, depends on the visual sense. And here there was a limitation. So how do you build the bridge and change the communication technique to communicate architecture? So initially what we used to do is like, we used to make models, block models, the cardboard models, so they could, the teachers and students could touch them and experience the space, experience the form. But there was this limitation because they could visualize the overall form, but then interior spaces were very difficult to gauge. That's where we started working with different textures, and we made textures with 3D printer. So we developed different textures through which what we did was we superimposed on the 2D drawing to give some tactility. So for example, this texture is the courtyard texture, or this lines that you see is for the corridor. Then when there is a dot, you know that there is a classroom. This is the exterior texture, and everything was written in Braille. So this was like a test, and then we made the tactile drawing based on that, on this different textures. So for example, in terms of movement, the outer wall has a very different pattern to the wall which is connected to the classroom. So students, when they touch, they understand that when they touch this part, they understand that on the other side is the courtyard. When they touch this wall, they understand this is the part of the classroom. And I think it worked pretty well. I mean, only a few things that they could not gauge, but I think most of the things they were able to gauge. And of course, they are partially blind students, so there is a different experience altogether. And then they were also very scared of that they will be breaking the model. And we were like, no, you have to touch and experience it. Breaks. Then we developed this 3D printed classrooms where we also put all the furniture and try to and make them understand what would be the interior quality. And I think it worked pretty fine. And it's a very sturdy model, so they could touch everything and experience this. We also created contrasting drawings. Still, this is in progress. I feel that it needs a lot of research and more work. That partially blind students can see 10% or 20% they have the vision. So they could identify spaces or surfaces through contrast. So these are like contrasting drawings, that patterns that we created, and then we superimposed again on the plan. But of course, as I said, that this needs more work, but I think that it has a lot of potential to communicate architecture. And this is my last slide. This is before the construction. We all, there was a group prayer, and then 1.5 years back, we started construction. It was delayed because of the pandemic, but I think maybe in a month or two, we should be able to finish the project. Thank you so much for listening patiently.
Thank you so much, Anand, for sharing your process with us, your deep commitment to a project, basically the intricate workings that your studio undertakes, your studies, and actually the way you execute your project was deeply inspiring. The efforts you've actually undertaken, your time at Perkins School to come back with the relevant knowledge and to apply further and to improve your projects, so commendable and so inspiring. Thank you so much for sharing your process and work with us. We appreciate it greatly. I would now like to invite our second speakers for the day, Teja and Yatin from Field Atelier, to please share their presentation. Thank you.
Can you see the screen?
Can you see the screen?
Yes.
Can you hear us?
Yes, Yatin.
So it was a very inspiring presentation by Anand. A very beautiful project. Yeah.
And thank you for the invite. Yeah. So our practice is 5 years old. We started a practice in 2015. So studio is based in Goa. So firstly, we'll be talking about two of our projects. One is a house in Asagaon, and the other is the house in Sanadurthum, which is ongoing. Firstly, I'm talking about house in Asagaon.
So we'll try to describe the feeling that the spaces have, because it's already built. So
And the house is located in Asagaon, a small and serene village in the north of Goa, built on a narrow plot of land, 12.5 meters in width, and is flanked by a house on one side and a busy village road in the front. The house is designed to be more inward looking and has its own atmosphere, responding to nature by means of open to sky courtyards. The side gradient of 2 meters is traversed very gradually through the house. The side facing the road is only a ground structure, and the rear part of the house is on two levels. Being a narrow, being a low structure in the front, it responds to the overall scale of the village. The spaces try to carefully maintain a balance between privacy of its inhabitants and the need to be sociable. Now, we wanted the house to be introvert because of its proximity to the village street, but without compromising the sociability of the house. And the house provides only a glimpse of the courtyard to the passerby, and the deep veranda in the front allows the homeowners to socialize and connect with the street below. This is a reference. This is a house, Casa Oro by Bernardo Rossi and Luigi Cosenza. What this image shows is a certain freedom in the space. You know, there's no conformity. Which is also the idea that we are thinking about whilst designing, as the houses to be sold by the client. So the end user wasn't certain. So if you see the plan. Yeah, so that's the entrance. We have an access of the courtyard and the garden behind. We enter into the living room, and there's a smaller courtyard here. Dining, kitchen. It's an open plan without any walls in between the spaces. So one enters into a beautiful view of the champa tree in the courtyard, and the visual access directs the eye towards the rear garden beyond. The living room opens into a larger open-to-sky courtyard on one side and a smaller one to the other, which fills the space with softened light. The wall behind the seating in the living room gives a bearing and a sense of security to the space. The two courtyards in the living room tell the time of the day and the season of the year. And the house does not try to keep the rain away, but gently lets it in. If you notice, the courtyard is a step lower and it's finished with limestone, so that the living spaces can sort of extend freely into the courtyard. It also becomes like an additional space, you know. Since the site is tight, it sort of gives an added space. The dining and the kitchen are undivided spaces. And the dining space is around 18 inches above, so one can comfortably sit at the edge of the courtyard. The bay window on the first floor overlooks the courtyard below and the village beyond. The staircase is a homogeneous mass finished with beige IPS design around the third internal courtyard. Large glass window floods the staircase with western light. The light and shadow constantly transform the staircase through the day. Though such light would be intolerable to some in the usable spaces, this acts as a sort of an ever-changing view for the people living in the house. These staircase landings are designed to have bay windows that provide a resting place. And the four solid shutters help to regulate the light and privacy as per one's preference and comfort. The bedroom also opens to the staircase space by means of a bay window, thereby releasing the pressure of that of the space. So the main principle behind the design of the house was to build the house with materials appropriate to create a feeling of serenity and beauty. Finishes such as beige hued IPS, timber for the roof and windows, white walls, unplastered gray ceiling, all come together to create a feeling of a whole. Light entering through the jalis, courtyards and windows placed high on the wall lets in indirect light, thereby avoiding glare. The columns demarcate the space and act as walls in an otherwise free space, by virtue of which the space is free flowing with abundance of light and breeze. The softened light entering the open to sky courtyards washes the floor and fills the space with warmth, And as the time of the day and seasons change, it transforms the space. The floors and the walls of the bathrooms are finished similarly as the rest of the house, thereby reinforcing the feeling of homogeneity in the space. While designing, decisions were left open. As in the premise of the house, but yeah, we, like for example, the roof of the courtyard, we sort of decided on site the proportions of it with make do mock-ups on site. So also improvisations are made on site, taking into consideration the skill and the knowledge of the builders on site. So the space is lit up by borrowed light, as in it's not direct. So just a reference in it's a building in Calcutta, but if you notice the light, it's it belongs to the courtyard. I mean, it's very specific to the dimensions of the space. This is also a courtyard in Ahmedabad. This is a drawing of a courtyard in Ahmedabad. But what's important is the light belongs to the courtyard. Throughout the house, the spaces are defined by the quality of light. In the bedrooms, the dark limestone floor and dark wooden ceiling changes the quality of light and creates a feeling of intimacy. The movable louvered shutters as well as four panel shutters allow the users to modulate the light and privacy as per choice without being completely cut off to the neighbors. And the open to sky courtyard, the verandas, the small terraces are the lungs and the core of the house. They provide the space with light, breeze, space to spill over, but more importantly, space to dream under a vast sky of one's own. And the house is primordial in its nature. The whole emphasis of the design of the house is not on the elements that make it, but on the feeling that a space evokes. And opening to the sky has an unfettered view of the sky or the cosmos beyond, unlike the horizon, which could possibly be blocked someday. A courtyard is an opening to the sky, proportioned to be intimate and of human scale. To think of it, the world outside a house is an entire universe, but one tries to domesticate the sky, the cosmos, the rain, the sun and the moon. The next project I'll be talking about is House in Salvador the Moon. This is ongoing. The site is located in an area with houses spread sporadically in the vicinity. It's almost like a wilderness. And the house sits on a site of 350 square meters with a gradient close to 1 in 5. And the surroundings are covered in dense vegetation, especially the front is densely covered with large trees. Hence, the house needs to be internal without being antisocial in order to respond to the setting. The initial feeling was to have a hortus conclusus of a domestic scale to which all space is open to. The light, the ventilation, and the views are borrowed from this court. And the wall to the outside gives a sense of security and protection from an uncertain exterior landscape. And the court also, and the house is located on a level contour, and the rest of the gradient is divided to contain a pool. One approaches the house is two levels. The pedestrian entrances entrance to the access of the house without having to negotiate steps, and other entrance at the lower level where one takes a flight of steps to enter the courtyard. The living, dining, and the kitchen are planned in a linear way. However, marginal offsets in the walls give each space a unique light and view of the outside. These are a few sketches which give an initial feeling of the site. The walls have a pink hue and a coarse texture, giving the space a mellow northern daylight through the day. And the house opens to western light through selective openings. The house needs a certain sense of privacy and feeling of refuge within the harsh wilderness. And to fulfill this feeling, the space had to be a bit darker, and hence the choice of the finishes. It's very similar to old bone houses where there is where the light is not uniform and there is moderation of light and dark. Although the darkness one gets to get used to as one uses the space. These are a few models, what we try to do is we keep the models unfinished, and so we can take a lot of decisions on site. Like for example, this window was left undecided, once the space was formed, we sort of planned this window overlooking the tree. This window also has solid shutters which can be closed, so it gives privacy at the level of the living room. The materiality of both the projects is very distinct to the atmosphere that the space requires. The materiality is never predetermined and is very specific to the needs of the site and the space. There is a small pool which is set 3 feet below the courtyard, and as one descends into the pool, the darkness of the finish adds visual depth to the pool, and the walls enclose oneself, inevitably directing one's eyes to the sky above. This allows one to be in silence. The darkness of the pool also gives privacy to sit in reflection. We assume when one uses the pool, this is a reference of a movie. Besides the utilitarian spaces, we seek to design spaces that are reflective and provide sensory pleasure to the inhabitant. Now this is a trellis and marble, but it's not important. At a certain time of the day, the light sort of dematerializes the marble, thereby making it one with the space. We also seek to make the courtyard a microcosm of the view beyond, with native plants which grow naturally in the surroundings. And this is also a reference of a courtyard. So that's the
that's
the courtyard. This is view of the courtyard. Yeah, that's about it. Yeah.
That's what we're planning to complete. So the, it's yet to complete. Yeah. So this is the last slide.
Thank you so much, Teja and Yatin, for a wonderful presentation showcasing your work, your thought process that brings together this process of creation. We thank you very much and we appreciate your process greatly. I would now like to open the session for conversation. We invite the audience to please share your questions for the speaker. I would also like to take this opportunity to welcome and introduce our moderators for today's conversation. Rimshi, who is a final year student at the Balwant Seth School of Architecture, Mumbai, and is currently a research intern at RME Architects. She has a keen interest in architectural theory. Welcome, Rimshi. Our second moderator for today's conversation is Lakshay Bansal, an architect from J.D. Goenka University, Gurugram. He's previously interned with Biome Environmental Solutions. With an interest in environment and landscape, he is also my colleague from BSLA and one of the co-members of the Open Space Collective team. Welcome, Lakshay. We request the audience to please share your questions for our speakers. Thank you.
Thank you, Verna, for the introduction. I'm feeling incredibly inspired today after viewing two wonderful presentations and the incredible work that the studios have engaged with. It truly gives me an insight into your practice and into your thought process as a designer. I think the first observation we made was that all the speakers have experienced learning from Professor B.V. Doshi, followed by an apprenticeship with architect Alvaro Siza for Mr. Anand, and with architect Bijoy Jain for architect Teja and architect Yatin. I could imagine that one would learn a great deal working with these masters, but along with those are the moments of other nuances which would leave a strong impact on you. It would be great if you could share some of these lessons with us, these lessons which had left a strong, which have really touched you.
Why don't Yatin and Teja share?
I think over a period of time, we've learned to sort of appreciate and sort of observe buildings by non-architects, you know, as
I think that's what we learned with, in a way, with Bijoy. It is to observe around, to develop a keen eye, which maybe we didn't have before that, because you see so many things happening around. So there were craftsmen and there was work going on in the studio, and it was up to us to learn what we can see, and either we learn or we don't. You know, so it was up to us to observe. Of course, at that point, it was more of a sense of awe, as we had not built and we could not really apply these things, but it kind of developed in us a certain way of looking at things, you know, which are not necessarily built by architects, but things that are built by, you know, makes basically the situations, you know, that cause a certain thing to be built on site or on the street, or, you know, Anand,
you can, yeah. Okay. No, it was really, really inspiring to see your presentation, because this is the first time I have seen the work in so much detail, and the sensitivity, I think, I would really like to come and see in person, yeah, to see the work.
Yeah, same, yeah.
So thank you so much for sharing this amazing work and really sensitive work. I don't know how to put everything organized thing that what I learned from Professor Doshi, Siza, Chenera, or other architects that have worked, because I think we are still in the process of learning, and the time we spent at Sangat or in Portugal at Siza's and Krishna's office were silent lessons that reveals over the period of time well be worth. So something it is not very concretely I could put, but some of the important values that I've learned, I feel that I could share that from both the architects. I think one very important lesson that I learned is to work slowly, because I remember that when I was at Sangat, Professor Doshi also always criticized me that I'm too fast in coming to the solution. So he, when I was a student, he used to criticize me a lot. And then over time, while I was working, I could understand this importance of working slowly and not coming to conclusions very fast. So that was, and I think in, with Alvaro Cesar, the same lesson that I learned, because he also takes a lot of time to come to a solution. So for example, there was one corner detail that you, I remember that he was working, it took him not many days to accomplish that detail, and I could understand the value of that and the amount of engagement and the drawings that he kept doing. So I think it was quite interesting. But another important lesson that I felt that I learned at Sangat was what Professor Doshi always used to say, that you should work without prejudice and you should question everything that you see. Education also, like how we have been taught, the way the practice is happening. Each and every aspect you need to be, like what Teja and Yatin was saying, that you have to have a keen eye, you have to question things, and you have to think about it, what is happening around. And in that process, I think many things we learned. So I think that was one important lesson I felt. Frugality was another lesson that I felt from Professor Doshi, that he always used to, like one instance that we used to write a letter to him, or even in our diaries, we take notes. So he used to see how big we are writing or how small. So he used to always criticize that, okay, you have to be very careful about the paper, you have to be careful about the resource you have. So like very small things, but they are so significant now when I think back. It's not only applied to yourself, but also the work that you do. So frugality was very important. And their architecture was not about spectacle. I think that was about human experiences. And I think that was, even in Alvaro Cesar's office, what I felt is that there was a very, very much obsession about work and hard work. So I remember that they used to work Saturdays and Sundays, and they were very obsessed with the work. Not to say that everyone should follow the same, but I think when you are working, you lose the sense of time, and I think that was a very inspiring thing that I also learned. And the last thing is that was a contrast that Professor Doshi used to always say, that you should not follow the history, you should work very intuitively and work as a child. And on the opposite, I think Cesar was saying that as architects, we don't discover anything new. We transform reality, and we work in the continuity of what works has been done before. And I really feel that it was a very important lesson, that we need to be also very insightful about what work has happened, not to mimic, but to understand the lessons and carry forward the spirit. But talking about what we could do in today's time, so. That was a very important lesson, I think. I think these are some of the things that I think are important. There are more, of course, but this is what I could remember quickly.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing your lessons from the past. I particularly liked, you know, when Yatin and Teja talked about not looking spaces as non-architects, because I think we are conditioned in some ways to look at spaces only in a way, you know, in the way we tend to look as, you know, as only in a particular frame. But, you know, when you start looking at non-architects, the spectrum of the way you look at space is much larger. And I think Anand
can still add in many points if he's you know, asked to. But I think these are very interesting points that you know, one can think about. And you know, Rimshi, I think if you would like to add in or continue upon this.
Thank you, first of all, for sharing such invaluable parts of your practice and experience with all of us. My question, going on to the question, it's towards architect Anand. What I noticed particularly was that you manifest most of your projects with so much ease and care, and most of the time they take their own elaborate process and they have their own unhurried pace. Like, as you mentioned earlier, that that's something that you learned from Doshi So and Siza, both of them. Whereas when in practice, people are more like architects more often are actually driven, the pace of the work is actually driven by clients. So how does one negotiate with others and make them understand the importance of this slow and unhurried process?
I think in my short experience, I can share that any project that you conceive, it's a collaboration between clients and architects and many other stakeholders which are involved. So I think, first of all, there is no difference, and it's a mutual process where, like, for example, in Jai Jagat Theater project, the client was a musician, his name is Nemo. When he gave me the brief, he gave me an hour presentation of what he thinks about amphitheater, or what his ideas about Sabarmati Ashram. So he was like very informed and excited. When he asked me, what is your condition as an architect? I said that since I have no experience working in such a historical place, I need to know this place well. So you need to give me enough time to understand the place itself first. So there is a dialogue, and then he understood that, of course, this is important. That's where he gave enough time. So he gave me almost, so the design of the theater took almost 2 years, the whole process, and then we built for more than 1 year. So not all clients, I would say, that would give you this opportunity. Of course, there are some clients who have specific deadlines, but then you set your priority and you create a dialogue, and there is a negotiation. So I think it's a part of the process. So for example, in School for the Blind, I got lucky because the project got because of the funding, it got so much delayed that I got so much time to do the processes. But for example, this BNL, we have like very tight schedule that we have to produce in a very specific amount of time, but then it's another challenge. So I don't think that all projects have a very specific way of working. You need to negotiate, and you need to understand what is your priority and what the project is, and balance that out somehow. And we are still learning. So many things we failed also badly in terms of processes. That's where you understand that what works and what doesn't work for you. But there is no set way. I think at least for us, we have decided. We just take all projects at a time, and then we learn from them and we improve on them.
Thank you so much for your input on that. We really hope that most of our audience can benefit from it. Moving on to the second question, Lakshya, will you like to take it ahead?
So to architect Yatin and Teja, what I notice is, as one starts taking a closer look into your projects, especially in case of house in Asagaon, one discovers a deliberate attempt at highlighting different elements using either materiality or methods of construction. We are curious to know as to how the journey between the drawing and the construction came up, and, you know, by the inputs of karigars at site, and, you know, how just they are built.
In fact, it's the other way around. The materials are not decided, before the project. We go by our feeling towards every space, what the space requires in terms of light, in terms of, and that's when the materials are decided. So also we improvise on site based on the constructions, you know, the skills of laborers. You know, we basically don't really stress on certain craftsmanship. We feel that if you are working with a team of people who have empathy towards what they are doing, the skill can be worked out, you know, and I think that helps in making the project beautiful, or, you know, or convey what feelings we have towards the project.
Like, for example, we are building a house, which is a very small house right now, where there's no contractor or a manager on site. They're just a mason who's doing the entire, just a couple of them.
He's training them, training the helpers.
Who's doing the entire house, you know. This sort of know-how which people have, we sort of work with that knowledge, you know. We don't try to sort of at times enforce, you know, certain preconceptions of ideas that we
of either materials or way of working with materials.
It sort of helps us also, these constraints of budget, site,
because then we find something that's new, you know, in the whole working of it. Then there's nothing set, you know, like Anand said, we also don't work with a set process. In fact, we think pretty similar. So we don't like to have a set process because we are still learning. We are a very small, practice. So it helps us to kind of find these.
Like also when we make models, if you feel that there is a certain finality that the model is achieving, it's trying to form, we stop, you know.
And we don't want the feeling to
get lost in the feeling of making the model. Then we like to take it to site, you know, because the
feeling.
Yeah, because it's exciting more than to sort of micromanage the light on the model, etc. So yeah.
I think, yes, that was the sort of answer I was hoping to get back. And I think it's very interesting. With this, I would now like to ask the audience question. And one of the anonymous attendees has asked, for both the practices, what is the inspiration for your work? A reference that you keep going back to?
Okay. It's a very difficult question.
It's directed to both of the studio. Yeah.
It's a very difficult question because I think by working, you don't have one reference or two references. There are a lot of different references that I don't know how I can put it like this, that while I was working on the theater project, the references were like very, very different. For example, when I was initially thinking about the process, and I also wanted to study how theaters have been evolved over time and in different civilizations. So that's where it took me to Theater of Demons is in Acropolis. That was one reference. Or we were also looking how Romans were building the theater, or how in our context in Sita Bengra and Jogi Mara case we were building the theater. So that was one set of references, very historical. Then the recent history, we were also looking at how Palladio had built the theater Olympico over time in 15th century in Renaissance. So then we were also understanding that what evolution happened. Then very recent Aldo Rossi's World Theater, that was something that was a floating theater. Wherever it went, it became the part of the place. So in that project, we were looking at many references. They were not like one reference. It's like that was one part of the reference. Then for understanding the place, we are also speculating how Sabarmati Ashram was. Then they were talking to people, how it was before, how ashram has evolved over time. So oral history became the reference. So I don't know, I mean, in terms of architects, of course, I like some architects than the others, of course, but that's not important. The important is that that you learn at different stages of projects, and those projects ask you these questions to search for something. So I don't know, for School for the Blind project, this when I was looking at the light, then I was also looking at Sir Johnson's museum in UK, where he brought like it was like a world within itself, and then he brought light from the roof in many different ways. So it was completely unrelated to the project. So there are like very random references that you go through while working. So yeah, I think this is the best I could put. I don't know if I answered this question, but yeah.
I think for us, you know, fortunately, we have a lot of built culture in Goa. As in, there are so many references of vernacular architecture. You know, golden houses with beautiful proportions. You know, so I mean, it just it sort of constantly adds to your sort of experiences. You know, and you know, so it's not a, I mean, you know, references are not, it's never, I mean, it's a sort of continuous process, you know? And not necessarily when you're building a house, your references would be houses, you know? Yeah. It could be paintings or, you know, like, it could be varied, you know, varied,
could be a church,
varied expressions.
Yeah. You know? Like, for example, the project we're doing now, we refer to churches, you know, because of the scale, because of the light. So the references could be anything, could be from a movie, could be from a, you know, something that you read, or basically it's a certain experience, you know, or it could be a nostalgic experience of your, you know, of your spaces that you possibly have
lived in.
Yeah, so it's varied.
But I think this anticipation of what the space behaves like when it's built, I think that, I mean, that is quite exciting, you know. Although I mean, you think of the space, and then you and then when it forms, you know, this anticipation of how the light would be, this really excites you. So yeah,
thank you so much to both the speakers, both the practices here and all the speakers. Due to lack of time, we'll be taking rest of the audience questions on Instagram. But very, very thanks for sharing such insightful things. And we are very thankful to Varna ma'am and my co-moderator Lakshay. Gautami will be taking off from here.
Thank you, Anand, Teja, and Yatin, for sharing your wonderful work and process with us. Thanks to our moderators, Lakshay and Rimshi, for engaging our speakers in a thought-provoking dialogue. To our audience for joining us, DU VSLA Clayworks team, have a great weekend.